Good evening. I'm Michael David Murphy, Digital Director for Atlanta Celebrates Photography. Welcome to the second installment of History Rewound. If you missed last week's episode on 35 millimeter rangefinders, it's here at our YouTube channel. You can get there acpinfo.org/YouTube if you're not here. Special thanks to Fulton County Arts and Culture, and particularly KEH, with whom we conceived this program as a view backward at some of the most celebrated photographers and photographs in the medium. Backward, I mean that our organizing principle will be the camera types and formats used by photographers to create the images, rather than looking at the images first. Our intent is to keep these presentations as accessible as possible. We hope you'll see something new, or perhaps rekindle a flame for a long forgotten photograph that may have mattered to you once. Maybe you'll remember the part of you that connected with it when you first saw it. The photos streaming past include some of the pictures we referenced last week and a few that we'll be getting into tonight. Before we get to tonight's presentation, I want to point you back to last week's introduction where I talked about this foundation of the historical canon of celebrations. Each week, it's important to remember why the history of this medium in particular lacks diversity of all kinds, racial, gender, and socioeconomic, while consistently asking what each of us can do to widen it, both retroactively and into the future. That said, what I'm presenting here is not definitive. It's a personal tour through photographs of both fame and familiarity, and hopefully, perhaps, a few that might be unknown but deserve a brighter light. For instance, the photo on the left might be new to you. What might the connection be between this picture from Alpe d'Huez and the 1986 Tour de France of Bernard Hinault? They called him the Badger. Leading American Greg LeMond, taken by Graham Watson. What it would have to do with a looping GIF of Tank Man in Tiananmen Square in Beijing in the spring of 1989? Can we make a connection between the two? I'm not so sure, but before we venture forth and find out, let's take a look at a video about SLRs from our friends at KEH.
The single lens reflex became the most popular design for cameras in the early 1970s and has stayed on top until very recently. This ingenious design makes use of a mirror and prism so you can focus and compose a shot through the same lens, projecting onto the film or digital sensor. Other classic form factors like rangefinders or twin lens reflex cameras don't allow for this, so SLRs offer an advantage for those that want an accurate preview of the final photograph. SLRs provide precision for photographers that require it for framing or focusing. The focus by eye design is especially useful for macro or telephoto lenses, as determining the depth of field at those ranges can be difficult to achieve with something like a rangefinder. Because of their flexibility, SLRs provide photographers with the most varied selection of lenses for virtually any application. The SLR design has been perfected through the decades by the introduction of many advances in photography, like autofocus, full program auto exposure, and through the lens metering. These features have made cameras more accessible and easier to use for beginners, aiding them in their growing popularity. There are a few disadvantages to the SLR design. For one, since the mirror blocks the prism as the photo is being captured, this causes a brief blackout in the viewfinder, making it difficult to track fast-moving subjects. Also, the mirror movement limits the speed of continuous shooting, and the somewhat noisy slap of it opening and closing can add unwanted vibration that may cause a loss of sharpness at slow shutter speeds. The SLR design is popular in a variety of formats, including 35mm, medium format, and digital cameras. The latter, the DSLR, worked much the same way as classic SLRs. only the film plane has been substituted with the digital sensor that's also capable of capturing video. DSLRs are starting to fall in popularity due to the rise of smaller, lighter, and more technologically advanced mirrorless cameras. But many still value the DSLR for its reliability, flexibility, and the vast selection of lenses and accessories available on the market.
In the video from KEH, we saw a Nikon and Contax. The incremental development of SLRs through the mid-century led to this breakthrough with the Nikon F system in the late 50s, early 60s. That system offered a new way of looking at the machinery of making pictures. You could have interchangeable accessories like a motor drive or an alternative viewfinder, and that flexibility went a long way to convincing photographers to make the sizable commitment to embrace new gear. But functionally, rather than mechanically, SLRs offered a chunky reliability, the ability to trust that your gear was going to be able to put up with whatever you might throw at it if you were a fictional photojournalist covering the secret war on Cambodia and Laos during the Nixon administration, or if you were a news photographer in Lewiston, Maine in May of 1965, like these fellows who, as you can see, were shooting a cornucopia of camera styles and formats while having the misfortune of being in the wrong place at the right time for this particular decisive moment, the famous fall by Sonny Liston at the right hand of Muhammad Ali. The SLR became the trusted machine for both accuracy and speed, and that led to its success and widespread adoption. SLRs were so ubiquitous, it's tough to know what wasn't taken with an analog 35mm SLR before the digital revolution. Commercial advertising photography, sports photography, fine art photography, nature, fashion, hard news, soft news, paparazzi, portraiture, virtually everything was shot with an SLR, especially in the 60s to the 90s. The core functions of the SLR and how it differed from rangefinders, as we've seen in the KEH video, was that it allowed nearly total precision of the visible frame. And this accuracy allowed photographers to mount huge lenses or wide lenses in a way that they were able to know exactly what they were shooting. There are many kinds of photography that shooting with zooms allows for. It allows you to get close to things you're not physically close to, like conflict in war-torn areas, or sports, which have their own sorts of conflicts. It bridges this eternal divide between photographer and subject. Yet in doing so, it compresses the space in a way that can be felt. Pictures taken with SLRs and zoom lenses, they tend to look like photographs that were made from far away versus this Robert Capa-ian up-closeness that we discussed last week. It allowed David Hemmings in Antonioni's Blow Up to zoom into parts of the park in London in search of a murder. It enabled Jimmy Stewart to sit in his wheelchair and do much the same out of his rear window. But beyond the kitschiness of Hollywood and how they chose to represent photography and what it means to make photographs, what the SLR really enabled was the chance for photographers far and wide to represent a vision of the world they were seeing in a sure-footed, just a little bit larger than compact way. And especially in the domain of photojournalism, where you could quickly make the photographs that just might change the world. Tonight, I want to focus on a few of those examples, situations that seemed perfectly made for the trusted ubiquity, the single lens reflex. On June 5th, 1989, there was a hotel in Beijing filled with journalists from around the world. China's military and security services had been battling and massacring pro-democracy activists and protesters the previous two nights. And at least five photographers were perched at various levels of the building. And they were looking back up the road as the tanks rolled in, as we see here in Jeff Widener's photo. Widener was on the sixth floor of the hotel on Shangon, a bit lower than a group of other photographers. He was shooting with a 400 millimeter lens on a Nikon FE2. He'd run out of film a few moments before or earlier in the day, and he sent out a friend to find some more. In the hotel lobby, his friend found an Australian backpacker who had a spare roll, and that's the roll that Widener loaded into his Nikon before taking this photograph. Now, you've seen this picture. You most likely know the story. Maybe not. If you happen to be in China, especially under the age of 20, chances are you would not have seen nor heard about this photograph, thanks to American companies like Cisco, who've helped China create the Great Firewall. It's a technological feat. Keeps 1.5 billion people from the ability to search and find this exact image when they look for Tiananmen Square or Tank Man. A few floors above Widener, Charlie Cole and Stuart Franklin were photographing from the same balcony with similarly long zoom lenses. The difference in their photographs is marginal, a little bit of color balance. This view here is Charlie Cole's, and Stuart Franklin's comes in there just a fraction of a second later as the tanks kept rolling toward the front and they're stopped at the top of the column, frozen in place by the lone figure. One of my favorite things about the history of photography is that there are these specific times and places where two or more photographers stood side by side or feet apart, and the difference in what they captured could not be more stark and recognizable. We'll continue to explore this idea over the remaining 3 weeks, this idea of how when using the same gear or even different gear, frankly, there's so much that can potentially go wrong or go differently or go a little less than perfect when comparing two or three various views of a particular situation. If we're lucky, there's a third format rolling, motion picture, live television, video cameras, to further contextualize the slice of time that these photographers in Beijing were able to capture. That what Widener and Cole and Franklin accomplished was engendered by the sturdy reliability of these SLRs, and Tankman offers a potent kind of visual proof that's irrefutable. While watching this sequence, it's hard not to think about other unedited moments of witness. When George Holliday stood on his balcony in Los Angeles on March 3rd, 1991, and witnessed the LAPD pull Rodney King over after a high-speed chase. It's hard not to think about Darnella Frazier, the 17-year-old high school student in Minneapolis in May, who bravely filmed those 8 minutes and 46 seconds when Derek Chauvin had his knee on George Floyd's neck. It's hard not to think about Dith Prawn, Eddie Adams, Noctua, or in this digital age, Lindsay Addario and Tim Hetherington, who all worked under this belief that photography can be an act of witnessing that which can't be witnessed by all, and that a photo might have the chance to give voice to the voiceless and shine some kind of revealing light on humanity, especially at our worst. That's what Tank Man standoff achieved. It showed the impotence of the state's power for two brief shining minutes, for the length of a still image to appear on the front of a newspaper. And the power of that act and the power of these photographs is still so palpable that it's a crime to view, print, copy, share these photographs in China today, more than 35 years later. Let's go further. We've talked about how ubiquitous SLRs were in the context of photojournalism, but they were for nearly everything else too, for documentarians, for artists like Carrie Mae Weems, who got her first camera as a gift from a boyfriend. These cameras were a gateway of expression in many of the same ways we're seeing now, with small mirrorless cameras and phones paving the way for new photographers into a lifetime of documentation and self-expression. This unquenchable urge humans have to document the world around them in hopes of gaining some kind of greater understanding of what it means to be alive might be best expressed by another SLR photographer in the 80s who said she had this need to remember and record every single thing, unquote. And here she is, Nan Golden, taking a self-portrait in a mirror to document the physical abuse from the domestic violence she sustained. Her work was raw and was the opposite of fashion photography of the 80s and 90s that tried to glamorize drug use. Like many photographers, she said she was drawn to make work because of the lure of fashion and its sexuality and glamour, and specifically, notably, Antonioni's blow up. But her view of her own world was far grittier and less stylized than cinema, offering the intimacy of not just her own injury, but injuries actually, but of loves and lives and fights and gender and discovering who you were as a young person in the unique, if you're going to make it here, you're going to make it anywhere neighborhoods of New York that back then weren't the commodified strip malls they've become in the last 25 years. Golden's slideshow project and eventual book, The Ballad of Sexual Dependency, showed a world that was uniquely her own and provided the next step on a ladder above what Larry Clark achieved with Tulsa 10 years earlier. It wasn't because she used a Nikon or Leica or 8x10. One of the great successes of her project and its influence on young photographers, especially today, is because it refused to compromise. Golden wasn't photographing her friends to make a buck or become an influencer or go viral on the gram. She was compelled to make the work as an ongoing act of remembrance for her friends that didn't make it through the AIDS crisis or overdoses or whatever abuse their lives hurled at them. For her to treat each of her subjects as unique and worthy and beautiful allowed her to create a record that would have vanished like so much of unique New York in that period. Her spotlight on society's margins, and in particular, her use of color, allowed her friends and the people closest to her to become symbolic of something larger, perhaps. Capitalism's unrelenting push to pave over individuality, to smooth out the roughest spots. Not just in the built environment and marketplace of, let's say, Lower East Side of New York City, but in people, and especially in the characters that inhabit Golden's work. It's her time, attention, and closeness that enabled this intimacy, an indelible way of working that will always be at the center of incredible image making. Thanks to Have a Nice Book for this video flip through, which I had to just look at a small section of the book for reasons I'm sure you understand. In a completely different way of working photographically, in an entirely different situation, there's a sequence that occurs in the documentary about James Nakwe. It's called War Photographer. It's available streaming, I think only on Canopy right now, if you have an Atlanta Public Library card, or if you go to school and have an account. A free account. It speaks to how Nakwe worked, and it's stuck with me since I saw the film in 2001. The filmmakers attached a small camera right on top of Nakwe's SLR. You can literally see how his patience and, let's say, his reluctance to be the kind of guy who's rattling off 12 frames a second, how that engenders him with his subjects, allowing the situation to breathe and unfold around him. And some of the same ways we discussed last week with the rangefinder. But the technique I can't forget is how Nakwe arrives on the scene here in Kosovo and uses his right hand as a way of gaining permission and consent, of assessing the sensitive nature of the scene and gaining the respect of those there. Just how simple his greeting is, how it connects with people at their most vulnerable and allows him to go about his work. Now, there's a lot of complications to this practice of photographing victims of conflict or generally marginalized people in distress. And how to be this kind of photographer. I can't speak for Noctway's entire career or character, but I continue to appreciate the seriousness with which he goes about his work and think this particular behavior is practical. It's something to model in photographic situations across the board. So what do these two have in common? First, the tank man photo asks questions that history has tried to answer for us. And for as much as we know about Widener and Cole and Franklin's experience, the photograph is an indelible reminder of who won, who lost. Each time we return to it, we wonder if or maybe how it might have turned out differently. The still photo's symbolic power is that it has these multiple doorways that open into unresolved rooms, in some way mirroring the hotel rooms on the other side of the cameras that made the tank man, the questioning of the photographers, and searches of their rooms immediately following the incident. Cole's film survived because he hid it in the toilet tank and snuck back in to retrieve it the next day. Franklin's film survived in a box of tea and was carried, smuggled out of the country by a French student. And somehow, we're all still searching with 1.5 billion people on the other side of a mountain of Cisco routers, trying to figure out if this was the last best chance for democracy in China, trying to understand that despite this documentary evidence, no one's come forward in the intervening years to definitively identify this man, to know whether he survived, was executed after making his stand at the crossroads of revolution and repression. Cycling photographer Graham Watson's photo on the left might feel innocuous by comparison. At face value, it's just another picture from the world's most colorful sporting event. But as a teenager, I stared at this photo and thousands of others like it until I knew the label on Bernard Hinault's blue cycling shoes. It was a pure photographic fact to be interrogated, and the questions never ended. I could never zoom in close enough to learn everything I wanted to know. The pages of the Italian magazine, you can only get so close. The pictures eventually dissolve into dots. And then I wondered what other perspective there might be on this moment. And I found it here, turn 3 on the Alp, which means it's 2 turns away from the top. The riders are high enough that you would see mountains gleaming miles and miles away. And in that moment, highlighted by a camera in a helicopter, I saw in the wispiness of the pixels, Graham Watson stepping out into the road, lining up his photograph. After he dismounted from his motorbike, the 2 riders in front of the 3 motorcycles, again, those mountains far off in the distance, another example where the making of the moment becomes that much more real and tangible because the smudges on this screen were real people once doing incredible things. And as Watson stepped into the road, knowing his fill flash coming from the left of his lens while shooting in portrait orientation with a pre-digital SLR, a Nikon F perhaps, would illuminate LeMond and Eno's eyes as they made the right turn and looked up the side of the mountain they had yet to finish climbing, putting everything their bodies could give on the line for the moment. Or athletic achievement, when one of them would get to raise their arms at the finish, cross the line, and coast into a new something that must have felt like freedom. Thanks for watching. See you next Thursday.